Come on, choir. Let's encourage them out there. Let's tell them that the blessing of Abraham is on their life. Oh, my brothers and sisters, because you are in Christ, you are Abraham's heir, and you have an inheritance on your life. You're the heir to the promise God made to Abraham. Go get your inheritance.
Talking about the blessings of Abraham that's yours on tonight. Oh, yes, you're the head, not the tail, above, not beneath, a leader, not a follower. Come on, somebody. Let's get excited about tonight's lesson. I am Pastor Lisa, the pastor of Quinn Chapel AME Church, and you are tuned in to Sunday School Nation, where we endeavor here to spread the love of Sunday School, what, all around the world. Oh, we're going to talk about our inheritance on tonight. Yes, we are. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So glad to have everybody on Facebook, everybody on YouTube in Sunday School Nation. Come on, let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, we give you honor and glory on this Thursday evening. We thank you, God, for this opportunity to come together to study your word together, even across the internet line. So, God, we pray for our internet tonight that it would hold up, that it would not be interrupted. In the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you, oh God, that there will be something that will help us on our Christian journey, something for us to reflect and think about. And oh God, as always, our prayer that we will be able to share something we learned tonight with somebody else. Amen. In Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Yes, we're going to talk about our inheritance on tonight, but we want you to know here at Sunday School Nation, your comments are welcome. Yes, please go ahead and put your comments in the chat. Let us know what's on your heart, what's on your mind, what are you thinking about. We are so pleased in the African Methodist Episcopal Church to have our own Sunday School Union. There's some fabulous study materials. We invite you to visit the website, amen, and see if there's something there that can help you with your studies. Tonight, we are continuing in our fall quarter. God's Law is Love. We are in Unit 2. Faith triumphs and the law fails. Faith triumphs and the law fails. And tonight's lesson is entitled, in the African Methodist Episcopal Church, the superiority of the gospel. If you're reading and studying the text in another commentary, it might say spirit and flesh on tonight. We always begin with the end in mind, so we always have some goals, objectives of what we want to accomplish with each and every Sunday School Nation lesson. So tonight, it is my desire that you would be able to identify how a person is and is not justified. Hallelujah. That you would be able to identify the difference between faith and works and how it impacts our life. And hallelujah, that you would understand that even as a Gentile, you are included in the promise of Abraham. Hallelujah. Yes, that's what we want to talk about on this evening. So we're in the book of Galatians. We were in the book of Galatians last week. We're in the book of Galatians this week, and we're going to be in the book of Galatians next week. So I thought I would start out a little bit talking about the book of Galatians and the place, more importantly, the place. Good evening to everybody. I see the Adumas are in the house. The Blackwells in the house. Hallelujah. Yes, yes. My big brother, Deacon Marcus May, is in the house. And my brother, Jacob, is in the house. And the Crenshaws are in the house. So glad to have each and every one of you here in Sunday School Nation. So let's talk about the place of Galatia. Galatia have a long history, Sunday School Nation. In the 3rd century BC, the area was invaded by the Gallic Celts. Let me show you what that kind of map looked like. And that is what gave the area its name, Galatia. And you see Galatia right there in the middle of the map. And Galatia means the land of the Gauls. Rome conquered Galatia in 189 BC and made it a province in 25 BC. The name Galatia first appears in the New Testament in Acts chapter 16, verse 6, as a region where Paul had preached the gospel. Amen. In the New Testament, Galatian believers often group with those in neighboring provinces. So Peter wrote to God's elect exiles scattered through the provinces of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Excuse me, Paul wrote to all these different places. When Paul addressed his letter to the Galatians, he wrote to the churches in Galatia rather than to a single church as he usually did with other letters. Scholars believe that the Galatians was most likely the first book of the New Testament to be written sometimes around Sunday School Nation AD 49. Paul had founded this church and was concerned because the new Galatian believers were being influenced by Judaizers, right? Those persons who were trying to convert the Gentiles and then say that they had to tap into the Jewish traditions, for instance, circumcisions, which we talked a lot about on last week. All right, so Judaizers were those Jews who taught that salvation required them keeping the Mosaic law, especially circumcision, as well as believing in Jesus. Amen. So the Galatian church was a mixture of both Jews and Gentile converts, and the Judaizers worked to convince the Galatian churches that the Gentile believers must be circumcised. Again, check out last week's lesson for more information about that. Before they could fellowship with the Jewish believers, Paul wrote to clarify what he had initially taught them, that salvation was by faith and what? Faith alone through the grace of God, and that it was extended to all believers. Now, Ephesians 2:8-9. Please put Ephesians 2:8-9 in your notes on tonight. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8-9. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8-9 says, "For it is by grace you have been saved," what? "Through faith. It is not for yourselves. It is the gift of God." It's nothing that you can do. It is a gift. "Not by works, so that no one can boast." Salvation comes through faith in God and faith in God alone. So Paul was dismayed at the way the Galatian believers were so easily, yes, by faith, so easily influenced away from the truth of the gospel. They had worked so hard, he and Barnabas and all of those preachers who were in that region, to tell them the truth, to spread the gospel, and then they were now allowing others to influence them and what they had been taught. So now I want to ask you, as we delve into our lesson tonight, turn with me to Galatians 1, 6 through 9. Galatians 1, 6 through 9. And this kind of sets us up as to why Paul was a little upset with the Galatian church. Here we go. Galatians 1, verse number 6. He says, Paul says, I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you to live in grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, not the one we preach to you, which is really no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one that was preached to you, he said, even if I lose my mind and come telling you something else, you stand on that initial gospel message. Let them be under a curse. And he included himself in that. As we have already said, and so now I say it again. Get it, Galatians. Get this in your thick head. If anybody is preaching to you a gospel other than what you accepted, let them be under God's curse. Woo! You don't want to be under God's curse, right? And so he continues this in his letter, this very strong language. So tonight we're in our lesson text. That quick. The Galatian church were moving away from the gospel message. They were being influenced by these Judaizers. Yes, stand on the truth that you accepted. Don't waver, don't doubt, stand on it. Thank you, Reverend. So Galatians 3 is where we're going to land tonight. Verses 1 through 14 is where we're sitting in tonight's lesson, the superiority of the gospel. Hear what Paul says to the Galatians. You foolish Galatians. Oh, you know Paul don't mince no words. He's a man that says what he got to say. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly exhibited as crucified. So he says, you foolish Galatians, strong language. He wanted to get their attention, number one, for sure. Using that term would definitely get it. But foolish here does not mean unlearned or ignorant, but foolish here is meaning that they have been given this idea, but they were choosing to go another way. Someone who can think but fails to use the power of perception. That's what foolishness means here. So the principles Paul referred to are the things that the Galatians knew, those things that he had preached to them. These things they had been taught. The knowledge and the understanding was there. They had grasped it, but they weren't using it. They weren't applying it. Amen. And they were allowing other people to put some other stuff into their brain. So he said, who has bewitched you? In other words, who's cast this spell over you? Who's covering up all that stuff that we had taught you? Hallelujah. It was before your eyes, 1b, that Jesus Christ was publicly exhibited. So when they were preaching the gospel, they publicly let it be known to everybody in that region that he was crucified. Now, there may have been some within who saw the crucifixion, who were witnesses to the crucifixion, but that's not the issue. Paul says, we put it on public display. And in my studies, he's talking about, we put it on those big banners that you see on the road when you're passing down, that Jesus Christ saves, that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins. Works is not going to save you, but the faith will save you. All those things, all those billboards were all around Galatia. That's what he's referring to. So they should be able to understand what was going on. Come on, verse 2. The only thing I want to learn from you is this. Come on, Paul says, help me understand what's going on here. Did you receive the Spirit by doing the works of the law Or did you receive the Spirit by believing what you heard? So that's that war that's going on in this church. Is it works or is it faith? Come on, which one is it? Paul says, help me to understand. Yes. Now, we know that in the Old Testament, while the Spirit was present, it was not an indwelling of the Spirit on the inside of the believers like it was in the New Testament. So Paul's point is that the Old Testament laws do not promise anything like what the Holy Spirit has for the believer. It is not keep the Sabbath and you will receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. The gift of the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost is experienced by the Galatian believer as a part of what? The new covenant. We got a new covenant based on better promises. Amen. When we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit then comes to live on the inside of us. It's a free gift as we accept Jesus Christ. Now, in the Old Testament, when they were really into the law, it was just something spoken of. But now we have the gift of the Holy Spirit. The unmerited favor of God gives us the Holy Spirit. And it's not by our works. It's a gift. That's what Paul wants to say. What we do or don't do does not predicate the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. However, the Gentiles were being told that they must come under the law of Moses or God will not bless them. They would not get the blessings of Abraham. This meant that he must be circumcised according to the law of Moses. So soon as you have that operations, that's what these Judaizers were saying. Hey, man, as soon as you get circumcised, then you can have everything. And that was far from the truth. Amen, my brother. Beware of false witnesses. You got to know what you know. That's why it's important to study the word of God. What? To show thyself approved, rightly dividing the word of truth. So the Galatians, they weren't rightly dividing the word. All right. And so these Judaizers was telling them, soon as you have that circumcision done and the cut is made, the Holy Spirit will then be poured out upon you. Of course, this is not how it works. We receive the Holy Spirit by faith. Just by believing, we get it. We don't have to be circumcised. So Paul asked them, did you receive the Spirit by doing the works of the law? Or did you receive it by believing in Jesus Christ? Again, he asked him, verse 3, are you so foolish? Come on, put your thinking caps on. Having started with the Spirit, are you now ending with the flesh? When we preached the gospel to you, you believed and you received it. Now, why are you reverting back to the flesh? What does he mean by the flesh? Why are now you trying to take yourself right back unto the law of Moses? We don't have to live under that law any longer. Yes, verse 4. Did you experience so much for what? For nothing. Because truth be told, the Galatian church was going through it, amen, as believers, because there was this section, they were being persecuted. The Christian church was a persecuted church. Go with me to Acts 14. Go with me to Acts 14. Let's talk a little bit about how the church was persecuted in its infancy stage. Acts 14, 1 through 7. Here we go. Keep your finger in Galatians because we're coming right back to it. It says, at Iconium, Paul and Barnabas went as usual into the Jewish synagogue. There they spoke so effectively that a great number of Jews and Greeks believed. Remember, I started out telling you the Galatian church was made up of Jews and Greeks. But the Jews who refused to believe stirred up other Gentiles and poisoned their minds. Do you see that, Sunday School Nation? Poisoned their minds, what? Against their brothers. So Paul and Barnabas spent a considerable time there speaking boldly for the Lord, who confirmed the message of his grace by enabling them to perform signs and wonders. The people of the city were divided. Some sided with the Jews, others with the apostles. There was a plot afoot among both Gentiles and Jews together with their leaders to mistreat them and stone them. And so this entire region was plagued by this mistreatment of these new believers, the church that's got started at Antioch. But they found out about it, and then they fled to Lycaonium, cities of Lystra and Derbe, and to the surrounding countries, where they continue to preach the gospel. So he was saying, all that persecution that we've gone through, all that persecution that you have gone through, are you doing that for nothing? Was that for naught? All right. Verse 5. Well then, does God supply you with the Spirit and work what? Miracles among you by doing the works of the law, or by you believing what you heard, or you believing what you saw? So we just read in Acts 14 how they were witnesses to these signs and wonders. And these signs and wonders were being performed via the Holy Spirit, not via what happened as their adherence to the law. So Paul is reminding them of that. Who supplied this Holy Spirit? Who supplied it? He answered that question. God himself supplied the Holy Spirit in response to faith. Hallelujah. Miracles are wrought by faith. How many times have we read stories of miracles? And the Bible says, and your faith has made you whole. And your faith has made you well. When God saw their faith. And so he is reminding them that the faith in God is one of those things that the Holy Spirit responded to. Yet the Galatians were deceived. It's deception. As my brother said, that they were being deceived by false witnesses, that the real spiritual riches lie in pursuing God through a works relationship. It's not about a works relationship, but it's about a faith relationship. So he repeats himself. Do you believe that you will be blessed by what? The works of the law? Or do you believe that you're going to be blessed because of the hearing of your faith? Amen. Come on. Let's look at an example of somebody who was very important to the Jews at this time. So he's kind of really focusing this part of the text to the Jewish believers. Verse 6. Just as Abraham, Father Abraham, believed God. Could you circle that in your Bibles or highlight that in your Bibles? Just as Abraham, what? Believed God, and it was reckoned to him as what? As righteousness. That's how we're going to end up, brother. Hold it. Hold that thought. So you see, those who believe are the descendants of Abraham. All right, so he's talking directly to the Jewish converts right now. Because Abraham believed God, it was accounted unto him to righteousness. And because you believe God, it's accounted unto you as righteousness. Because you what? You are the descendants of Abraham. Go with me to Genesis. Come on. We getting ready to all be included, even though he's talking to the Jews right now. Abraham believed God. Yes, he did, Sister Pam. Even though he's talking to the Jews, let's bring everybody into it. Come on. Yeah, the blessings of Abraham are for everybody. Genesis 15, 1 through 6. Oh, I love this verse. Genesis 15, 1 through 6. The Bible says, after this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield and your very great reward. Remember, Abram's name is going to be changed to Abraham. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless and the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, you have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. Then the word of the Lord came to him. This man will not be your heir. Hallelujah. But a son who is of your own flesh and blood will be your heir. He took him outside and said, look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. Well, we know you can't count the stars. It's way too many. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. And verse 6 says, and Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. Abraham believed God, as my sister Pam has putting up there. Now, this particular scripture, if you see coming up on your screen, Abraham believed the Lord and credited to him as righteousness. And this part has been quoted several times, and I've got the references for you in the book of Romans. Paul uses this phrase a lot. And it simply shows us tonight, Sunday School Nation, that righteousness was accounted to Abraham simply because he believed. Not because of circumcision, simply because he believed. Not because he was being adherent to the law or commandments, simply because he believed. Hallelujah. And the truth be told, circumcision had not been given at that time. They did not have the law at that time. It was accounted to him unto righteousness simply because he believed. All right, verse 8. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would reckon as righteousness the Gentiles by faith, declared the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, all the Gentiles, woo, right there. That scripture right there. All the Gentiles shall be blessed, what? In you. When he was looking up into those stars, the Gentiles were included in that count. Come, go with me. Genesis 12, 1 through 3. Then we're going to look at Ephesians 1, 3 and 4, 3 through 14. Let me change that. That's going to be 3 through 14. We're going to look at that on tonight. All right, here we go. Genesis 1 through 3. God had made it clear to Abraham that all nations will be blessed through you. Then the Lord said to Abram, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I'm getting ready to show you. I will make you into what? A great nation. The Abrahamic covenant is what we're talking about. I will bless you. What? I will make your name great. Hallelujah. And you will be a blessing. Guess what I'm going to do? I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you, and on all people. Come on. And on all peoples of the earth. Yes, Jews, Gentiles, black, white, big, straight, crooked, whatever, all peoples on the earth, what, will be blessed through you. So that blessing of Abraham comes on us. So let's come on. Let's that Abrahamic covenant. Yes, it is. Let's mark that in our Bible so that we know that we are a part of the promise. Now I want to look at Ephesians. Let's solidify it a little bit more. Ephesians 1. Go back down here. Ephesians 1. Put this in your notes. Glory to God. Yes, yes, Sister Tina. Glory to God. Praise be to God. Ephesians 1, 3 through 14. Praise be to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Everything we need, amen, to be on this Christian journey, God has already blessed us with it. For he chose us. Come on, let's make the connection on tonight. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. Come on, it gets better. In him we have redemption. I'm going to talk about that a little later. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Hallelujah. In accordance with the riches of God's grace, what? That he lavished on us. Yeah, yeah. He poured his grace on us. Hallelujah. With all wisdom and understanding. That's why he's calling them foolish. You don't need to be foolish. God has even gifted you with wisdom and understanding to accept the fact that it's not by works, but it's just by a simple belief in who Jesus Christ is. Verse 9, he made known to us, hallelujah, the mystery of his will. Come on, with according to what? His good pleasure. It pleased the Lord to do this for us, which he purposed in Christ to put in effect, which the times would reach their fulfillment. Yeah, we are a part of that fulfillment. When we accepted Christ, we became a part of the plan. Hallelujah, Sunday School Nation. We were a part of the plan. We were chosen from the very foundation of this world. Hallelujah, praise be to God. To bring unity to all things in heaven and earth under Christ. Oh, yes, to bring unity, to unify the Jews and the Gentiles, to unify the slave and the free, to unify the male and the female, so that we could all be one under Christ. Verse 11, in him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we who were the first to put our hope in Christ might be for the praise of his glory. We put our hope in Christ through our belief, Sunday School Nation. So here is the faith of Abraham that was inherited for us. And you, because he's talking to Gentiles, and you were also included in Christ when you heard the message of the truth, the gospel of your salvation, when you believed. Hallelujah. When you believe, something important happened. You were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. Oh, it came to live down on the inside of you. It wasn't about whether you were circumcised or uncircumcised. It wasn't about whether you went to the rabbi school or didn't go to the rabbi school. You were marked with him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing. Ooh, do you like that word? Guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory. Oh, hallelujah. Don't you love it? Don't you love it? Come on, now we're ready to go back. Let's go back to our lesson. Hallelujah. Let's finish shouting tonight. Yeah, God chose us from the very beginning. He included us in the very beginning. He put his seal on us when we believed. Hallelujah. So now we are part of the blessing, not the cursing, but the blessing. Hallelujah. Yeah, when we finish shouting, come on, let's go back. Let's go back to our lesson. For those who are joining us, we're a Sunday School Nation. Hallelujah. We are studying in Galatians chapter 3, and we are on verse number 9 on tonight. Galatians chapter 3, verse number 9. Here we go. Paul says to the Galatians, for this reason, those who believed are blessed with Abraham. Who what? Believed. Yeah. Those who believed were blessed with Abraham, who believe. Yeah, and that inheritance, thank you, Sister Pam, is a guaranteed inheritance. So this brought great comfort to the Gentiles who heard Paul speaking this, but it also brought comfort to the Jews who were reading this letter as well. And I tell you, it brought some comfort to me tonight to remember that we too are included into the promise of Abraham. Hallelujah. And I also kind of took me back to Vacation Bible School. Y'all remember Vacation Bible School? Father Abraham had many sons, and many sons had Father Abraham, for you are one of them and so am I. So what? Let's just praise the Lord. Let's praise the Lord as we remember that anyone, whether Jew or Gentile, who is faithful to Christ is blessed. Verse 10, For all who rely on the works of the law are what? Under a curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not observe and obey all the things written in the book of the law. So back in the Old Testament, the premise was you had to obey all of it. And if you didn't obey all of it or fell short of all of it, then you would be cursed. Go with me to Deuteronomy. And I'm going to encourage you tonight to read Deuteronomy 27 and 28. But we want to look at Deuteronomy 27. Yes, something to praise the Lord about for sure. Especially when we get to this part. When we remember we're free from the curse on tonight. Hallelujah. We are free from the curse. Deuteronomy 27 verses 15 through 26. I'm going to paraphrase on tonight. The verse 15 says, cursed is anyone who makes an idol, a thing detestable to the Lord, the work of skilled hands, and sets it up in secret. Then all the people shall say, amen, which means all the people shall say, it is so. Cursed is anyone who dishonors their father and their mother. Cursed is anyone who moves their neighbor's boundary stone. Cursed is anyone who leads the blind astray on the road. It's so many laws, y'all. Cursed is anyone who withholds justice from the foreigner, the fatherless, or the widow. Cursed is anyone who sleeps with his father's wife, for he dishonors his father's bed. Cursed is anyone who has sexual relations with any animal. Cursed is anyone who sleeps with his sister, the daughter of his father, the daughter of his mother. Cursed is anyone who sleeps with his mother-in-law. Cursed is anyone who kills his neighbor secretly. Cursed is anyone who accepts a bribe to kill an innocent person. All these laws. Cursed is anyone who does not uphold the words of the law by carrying them out. And when you continue to read, it's curse after curse after curse after curse. Hallelujah. But the blessing came. They said, if you would obey the law, if you would obey God's word, then you would be blessed. So we are thankful tonight. Hallelujah. Because who can keep up with all that? It just tires you out just to read curse after curse after curse. And we want to live and know that we live in the abundance of grace. Ooh, aren't you glad for grace? Because Jesus died on the cross for our sins. And all we have to do is simply believe, amen, and accept his grace. Come on here. That's why Paul is saying, are you foolish? Is that what you want to go back to? You want to go back to being under the curse of the law? Or do you want to live in some grace on tonight? Come on. Don't be foolish. Don't be duped. Don't be tricked. Because we know that this was a trap of the enemy. Deception is a trap of the enemy trying to tell you something. Amen. That is untruth and get you to believe it, to move you out of, amen, enjoying the new covenant that Jesus brought with us. Verse 11. Now it is evident that no one is reckoned as righteous before God by the law, for the one who is righteous will live by faith. Brother, I told you I was coming for it. I'm coming for it right there. Yes. Habakkuk 2 and 4. Habakkuk 2 and 4 says very simply, the just shall live by faith. Yep, yep. It's that simple. And Paul quotes that a numerous of times trying to get it over to the Galatian church. The just shall live by faith. Verse 12. Let me put our lesson back up. But the law does not rest on faith. The law don't rest on faith. On the contrary, whoever does the works of the law will what? Live by them. So do you want to live your life under the law, or do you want to live your life under faith? Amen. And the grace of God. Which one? Which one do you want to live under? Which one do you want to focus your attention on? Which one do you want to eat, live, and breathe? And so we know as believers, we live by faith. We eat by faith. We sleep by faith. We walk by faith. As my brother said, we walk by faith and not by sight. Hallelujah. Leviticus. Paul is referring to Leviticus here, 18, that simply says, you shall therefore keep my statutes and my judgment, which if a man does what? He shall live by them because I am the Lord. But the Lord now is asking us to live, not by the law, but to live by faith. Next week, we're going to see why the law was important. What was it, its purpose? So hold on to that thought for next week. Come back and see what we're going to learn about that. But now we know that Paul says we're not living by the law, but we're living by faith. Praise God. Because Christ has redeemed us. Verse 13, Christ redeemed us. Remember, I told you I was going to talk about redemption, right? Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. All those curses that we read about in Deuteronomy, Jesus became the curse, so we don't have to be in bondage to the curse anymore. Yeah, I choose faith. Jesus removes the curse. He became the curse for us, for it says, cursed is everyone who what? Hangs on a tree. Because the wages of sin should have been death. But we know the gift of God was what? Eternal life. Hallelujah. So Jesus came, he buys back. He redeems us back. He pays the price for our sin so that we don't have to. He becomes the curse so that we can be blessed. Oh, thank you, Holy Ghost. That one just dropped in my spirit. Jesus became the curse so that you and I, Abraham's children, we can be blessed. And that plan was established from the very foundation of the world. And we're here at Sunday School Nation. We made it. Verse 14, in order that in Christ Jesus, hallelujah, the blessing of Abraham, woo, the blessing of Abraham might come to what? The Gentiles, so that we might receive the promise of his spirit through faith, through simple belief that Jesus Christ was born, that Jesus Christ, he lived, that Jesus Christ walked this earth, that Jesus Christ died on the cross, that Jesus Christ arose from the dead, and that Jesus Christ, hallelujah, went up to heaven, and that Jesus Christ is one day coming back. Hallelujah. You accept all those things by faith on tonight and receive his grace and walk in it. That is our lesson, for we walk by faith and not by sight. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. Our walk is a faith walk. Praise the Lord. And that's the superiority of the gospel. Has nothing to do with the law, has nothing to do with circumcision, but it's all about our faith in Jesus. Oh, I thank God for faith on tonight. Yes, yes, I praise God for being our kinsman redeemer. Yes, he was. Oh, yes, he was. Hallelujah. Thank you, Sister Pam. Appreciate this. Yes. And amen to that. Yep, that's it. It's simple. It's simple. Faith. Faith over the law. It's simple. Yes, yes. Tonight, if you have a prayer request, we here at Sunday School Nation want to pray with you. So thank you for tuning in to Sunday School Nation tonight, being a part of our nation. And we pray that you will be able to share something that you learned tonight. I hope that Galatians, this text is pretty deep. A lot of connections to the Old Testament. But that Sunday School Nation is what Sunday school and what Bible study is all about. You can read those scriptures, but you got to make those connections. You got to jump around. That's what we do here at Sunday School Nation. Come on. Put your prayer request in. All right, Sister Jackie. Thanks, brother. Love you. Our friend Sherry's only son. Our friend Comfort and Strength. We're praying for comfort and strength for Sister Sharon. Sherry's only son, I believe. Sister Duma, I can't see the end part. Let me go to my chat. I might be able to see it a little bit better. It's cutting off for me. Go ahead, put your prayer request in on tonight. Put your prayer request in. There you go, Sister Duma. Oh, okay, I can see it now. Our friend Sherry's only son was killed by his girlfriend, and we're praying for this comfort. Oh, my God. Yes, 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 yes. Hallelujah. We're praying for Sister Sherry on tonight. What a tragedy. What a tragedy. Hallelujah. Yes, yes. What a tragedy. Hallelujah. Couple of announcements that we want to share as well on tonight with you. For those of you who are in Ohio, please remember that you can vote now. We're voting, asking you to support yes on issue one for our rights, our freedom, and our power. Early voting has begun and you may vote. We'll also know that October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And early detection saves lives. So we are asking everybody to remember and to, ladies, let's get our mammograms. Gentlemen, let's get our mammograms. Early detection saves lives. And so we definitely want to do that. Amen. Pray for our government. Yes. Yes, my brother, we're praying for our government on tonight. Praying that we remain steadfast in spite of everything that's going on. Hallelujah. Yes, come on, let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, we thank you and praise you, oh God, for your gift of grace on tonight. We thank you for reminding us that we are included in the blessings of Abraham, that we are above only and not beneath, oh God, that we are the lender and not the borrower, and we come behind in no good thing. Oh God, we are the head and not the tail, and we thank you, God, for the blessings that you have given us. God, you said Jesus came to this world that we might have life and have it more abundantly. So right now, God, we pray for our minds, that we will keep our minds committed to studying the word of God so that we too will not be deceived by the tricks of the enemy, Father God. We thank you that as we continue to study our word, that your word will become a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Father, we thank you for your grace on tonight. We thank you for being our kinsman redeemer. We thank you for becoming the curse for us, oh God, in the mighty name of Jesus. And then, Father, we pray right now. We pray right now for Sister Shelley's son, God, a tragic way to end this young man's life. So we know that not only is Shelley's family's life devastated, but even the girlfriend's family. Oh God, life is it's a devastating fact on for both families. So we're praying right now for comfort. We're praying right now for strength. God, we're praying for wisdom and understanding. We pray right now for healing to transpire, healing to take place, God. Comfort your people in the mighty name of Jesus, God. We're praying tonight for our government, God. Our government is in a chaotic situation, but God, as we prayed and you reminded us, you got the whole world in your hand and you asked us to pray for our leaders. So tonight we pray for unity, we pray for strength, we pray for reconciliation, we pray for understanding. God, we pray that we will no longer be deceived by political ideology, oh God, but that we would come under the umbrella to serve the people in the very best way we can. God, you know who that next speaker is going to be. So we pray right now for a righteous leader. We pray right now for a leader who has an heart to turn to you for guidance and direction. We pray right now for a Holy Spirit-filled leader to help lead our country. In the mighty name of Jesus, God, we're asking, oh God, that you would comfort us during these terrible times, God, that you would allow us, God, to just stretch out on you, God. As we draw closer to you, please draw closer to us. Keep us under your divine protection. Keep us under your divine security. Keep us, oh God, as we're walking to and from during our day today, God. Be a fence all around us, God. Comfort us today, God. Touch us today, God. Heal us who needs healing today, God. In the mighty name of Jesus, God. And we continue to keep a prayer on our lips, and we will continue to keep thanksgiving in our hearts, God, because we know there's no God like our God. We know that we can do all things through Christ who gives us the strength. So God, allow us to hold on to your unchanging hand, God, remembering that we will reap if we faint not. In these times, oh God, let us not grow weary in well-doing, God, for we will reap in due season if we don't faint. So we ask right now for strength. We pray right now for strength. We pray right now for comfort. And most of all, God, we pray for your peace, a peace that surpasses all understanding. And yes, as my brother says, you are the Prince of Peace. And we thank you that it envelops this world on today. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen. Thank you so much for tuning in to Sunday School Nation. Next week, we're going to continue this lesson with Galatians chapter 3. Go ahead, reread the first 14 verses and keep going all the way to the end. We're going to finish it out on next week and talk about why, amen, the law was put in place, but now we're still under grace. Let's not forget it. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Remember, Sunday School Nation, hallelujah, the best time you can spend is your time studying the Word of God. See you in worship, Quinn Chapel, 11 a.m. on Sunday. God bless everybody.